Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, last week we started from the subject, the inside out life. Say the inside out life. Now, we want to talk about the maintenance of the inner life. Say the maintenance of the inner life. And I've come to find out, if you don't know how it is that you're made, we're at a disadvantage. When we come to understand how it is that we are made, then by the help of the Holy Spirit, we can maintain the inner life, our inner life. Say the inner life. It's the part of you that nobody sees, but is very much felt when we encounter the world around us and the people. And so God wants you and I to have absolute victory. But in order for us to have that, we need to understand how our inner life is made up and how we're affected by what happens in our inner life. Amen. Bless the Lord. And so the Bible has a lot to say about our inner life. Amen. Now, last week, we started off in, let's just do this for the sake of laying a foundation. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses... Let's start again. Look at verse 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3. Say the inner life. It says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, light shining out of darkness, have shined in our hearts. So where has God shined his light? In our hearts, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 7. For we have this treasure in earthen vessels. The earthen vessel is you and I. The treasure is God's Spirit. Say the earthen vessel is you and I. The treasure is God's Spirit. So we're housing glory in clay vessels. Come on, say, we're housing glory in clay vessels. Now, not only is God's Spirit living there, but it is your human spirit via a relationship with Jesus Christ, which is in communion with the Holy Spirit. That's the part of you that nobody else sees. Nobody sees your inner life. But you are very much responsible for maintaining your inner life. And so we want to talk about how it is that we are to maintain our inner life if we're going to live from the inside out. Amen. So what are we talking about? We're talking about the highest dimension of who you are, your spirit life. Say my spirit life. And then it's the other side of the immaterial part of your life that no one else sees, which is your soul life. These are very vital to our understanding of how we're to live from the inside out. We must maintain our inner life if we're going to live in victory. Come on, say amen. Then he says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of ourselves. Now, this power is supernatural. It is not of your own ability to maintain your inner life. It is not of you or I, but it is of the Spirit of God. It is us in cooperation with the Spirit of God who supplies the power. See, there is an unlimited supply of power for you and I to maintain our inner life in cooperation with the Holy Spirit. Come on, say amen. Why is this important? Now, watch this now. See, if you have a strong, fortified inner life, then you can deal with what's about to come. Because he says, Look at what he says. We are troubled on every side. Anybody here acquainted with trouble? We are troubled on, he didn't say just one side. He says, in other words, your life is enraptured in trouble. We are troubled on every side. In other words, you find yourself in one season of trouble, and you come out of that season, then you find yourself in another season of trouble, and it seems like trouble is inescapable. We are troubled on every side. But I love that as we continue to read what the scripture says about this victory that we have because of this treasure that we have on the inside. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Glory to God. You can have trouble coming from the outside, but you don't have to have trouble on the inside. In other words, you don't have to be confused, falling apart, becoming disjointed, fragmented, about to lose your mind. You can have trouble on the outside, but trouble don't have to be on the inside. In other words, the pressure on the inside, the outside, does not have to bear its weight upon you to where you're troubled on the inside. You're unstable on the inside. What is being unstable on the inside? Emotional instability. Because life has a way of creating emotional instability. He says, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed. You ever not been able to figure out what in the world is going on? We are perplexed. How am I going to get out of this? Why is this happening to me? We are perplexed, but not in despair. I love that. See, only God can do that. We are perplexed. Don't know what in the world is going on, but I ain't in despair. I ain't got to try to keep it together. God's got it together. Why? Because I'm trusting in the Lord. What am I doing? Leaning not to my own understanding. In all of my ways, I'm acknowledging him. And what is he doing? He is path. In the pathway of the just, there is light. So we can expect that when we're perplexed, there's still going to be light. Come on. I wrote a post on Facebook. We don't always have to know how things are going to work out. We just need to know that they are going to work out. Why? Because with God, all things are possible. So as I fortify my inner life to this reality, when I come into perplexing seasons, I don't fall apart. Come on. God wants us to have it together, but have it together by revelation knowledge of who helps us keep it together. Come on, you can give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that. And I love this. He says, we are perplexed, but not in despair. Amplified Bible says it this way, verse number 8. We are pressured in every way, hedged in. Anybody ever felt like you've been hedged in? But not crushed, perplexed, unsure of finding a way out, but not in despair. Verse 8, King James 9 says, persecuted, but not forsaken, cast down, but not destroyed, always bearing about in the body of the, bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. His life, his glory, his power be made manifest in our mortal, short-lived, decaying bodies. His power is being made manifest every day, glory to God, that we live in union with him by his spirit. And so say the inner life. He says, again, King James, verse 4:16, for which cause, here it is, drop down, for which cause? For the cause of what we just read. For which cause we faint not. Come on, in other words, we're not going to fall apart. We're not going to go crazy, glory to God. We're not going to turn coward. We're not going to become punks in the spirit. We're not going to give up, glory to God. Amen. For which cause we faint not. I love this in the Amplified Bible, verse 16. Therefore, we do not become discouraged, spiritless, disappointed, or afraid. Though our outward self is progressively wasting away, yet our inner self, say inner self, is being progressively renewed day by day. Your inner self. See, this is why we got to understand our inner life. We got to understand the components of our inner life. If we're going to live from the inside out, which is the way God wants us to live, out of the new recreated spirit, which you now have by way of your union with Christ, your spirit man is now alive unto God, which is now the apex of your life. It used to be in the low place because our fall from sin created death, and the soul itself became damaged by sin, and the spirit man was suppressed, and your flesh life took the rule, and now your spirit man in union with Christ now comes back to the place of reigning in life with Christ Jesus. So we got to live out of our inner life, which is in union with Christ. Come on, stay with me. That's a good word. Now, how are we going to maintain it? Go to Ephesians. Let's break it down. Let's maintain this thing. Because there's some struggles. Tell your neighbors that there's some real struggles. And some of this stuff perplexes us by the struggles that we find ourselves still going through, having yet still come into union with Christ. We find out that there's some real struggles still going on in our inner life. And so how do we deal with that? How do we circumvent that? How do we bring that into harmony with God's will and purpose? We must do it by the help of the Holy Spirit and by way of the truth of God's word. And so here in Ephesians chapter 3, we got to look at what Paul says by the Spirit. We want some context. Watch a verse 16. 3:16. What I tell you? Ephesians 3. Yeah, we did say that, didn't we? Well, let's do this. Go to Ephesians chapter 3. Let's start at verse 10. Let's get some context. All right? You're right. Verse 8. You want some real context. Unto me, who am least than the least of all the saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world have been hid in Christ, the fellowship of the mystery, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Somebody shout, Jesus is God. Who created all things by Jesus Christ, which makes him creator. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be made known by the church, that's you and I, the ecclesia, the manifold wisdom of God. So we're teaching angels about the purposes and the plans of God as they see us executing our kingdom assignment in the earth. They're getting revelation knowledge about God. Watch this now. According to his the eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness. Say we got boldness. And access with. This is good. Not only boldness. Come on now. Watch this now. Boldness and access. You got confidence to come into his presence. That's all that says. With confidence by the faith of him. Who? Jesus. Wherefore I desire that you faint not at my tribulations for you, which is for your glory. Paul says, I'm going through this just to demonstrate the power of God. You got to see somebody go through something to enrich your faith. Listen. Watch this now. As a pastor, I am thoroughly excited not just about my faith, but when I see your faith, when I see you walking through what you walk through with the power of God holding on to, when I see your faith being demonstrated, come on. Got to get excited. Don't get excited just about your faith. Get it. Oh, glory to God. Get excited about somebody else demonstrating their faith in this infallible God who we serve. That's powerful. Now, what verse was I in? Help me out. That was verse 8. 13. Okay, yeah. Wherefore, I desire that you faint not at my tribulations for you, which is for your glory. Now, look, here it is. Here's a good part. See, here's a good part. Because here's where the victory is. For this cause, I bow my knees. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, if you're going to maintain your inner life, you're going to have to learn how to bow your knees. They used to call it kneology. You got to learn. You know what, Pastor? I don't even mind a little bit of pain. I told my wife that I get on my knees so much. Sometimes, you know, I don't have calluses on them, but my knees get sore because I spend hours sometimes praying. And because I'm on my knees, I'm also on my elbows in prayer. And my elbows get a little sore sometimes. But I said, devil, that's my posture, because I know when I bow my knees, you in trouble. And when I bow my knees, what am I doing? I'm solidifying and I'm testifying to God that I'm dependent upon you. My strength comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. I place no confidence in my own flesh, my own ability. God ain't gonna get, come on now, my flesh ain't gonna get me out of the stuff that the devil throws at me. God's power has to be made available to us as we hold on to him in prayer. So I bow my knees. Paul said, for this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named. Look at this now. Look at how powerful this is. Paul said, I'm praying for you that God would give you this. He said, I'm praying for you that God would give you this, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. Say, I need this revelation. According to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his spirit in your inner man. In other words, Paul ain't praying for you that God would take you out of everything that you're going through. He's praying that God would strengthen you with might by his spirit in your inner man. Because if your inner man is strong, you can weather any storm that you come on that confronts you. We need a strong inner life. Now, we good at maintaining the outer life, but if you're going to weather these spiritual storms, if you're going to contend with stuff that you can't even see, you got to be fortified inwardly. When stuff come against your soul, glory to God, you got to be fortified inwardly. And Paul is saying, I'm praying that you would get a revelation of how powerful the outcome is of you bending your knees. Come on now. Woo, bend your knees. He says that you would, that he would grant you according to amplified. Let me shift, amplified. Verse 16. That he would grant you out of the riches of his glory to be strengthened and spiritually energized. I love that. Woo, my God, strengthened. And see, there is sometimes that under the weight of the pressures of life, your outer man can get so fatigued. Not only your outer man, but the immaterial part of you that you don't see, which is your soul. See, it's one thing to be physically tired, but it's another thing to be filled with cares and anxiety and all kinds of things weighing on your soul when you can't even lay down and sleep. You lay down for 8 hours, but maybe you only sleep one, that you're not resting. And so we become fatigued and weary physically and also soulically, but if we have a strong spirit. Watch this now. That inner man, energized with what? With power through his spirit in your inner man. So if your inner man gets strengthened, if your inner man is strengthened, your outer man's gonna benefit. Come on, say it with me. If my inner man is strengthened, my outer man's going to benefit. There are sometimes, man, I've been so bone tired and I just come through a season like that. And I know you know about it. I mean, yesterday I was just so tired. I woke up this morning so tired. Matter of fact, Pastor, I told my wife, I said, baby, go get me a Pepsi. I said, baby, I need something. Go get me a Pepsi. But I'm going to tell you something now. Engaging in spiritual dimension of worship. While I'm worshiping and singing those songs of revelation back to God, physically tired, but all of a sudden I'm quick and I want to dance now. Come on now. Body said, no, don't move. I'm saying, yes. Come on. Spirit man saying, come on. Come on. Express your passion. Come on. Come on. Watch this now. Let's go to Psalm 103. Psalm 103. Hallelujah. Body gonna have to comply. See, the devil don't know what's about to happen. There's an avalanche about to hit him. There's a tsunami about to hit him. And let me tell you who the avalanche is gonna be and the tsunami gonna be. It's you. Just this one verse. Look at what David says. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Amplified Bible says it this way. Bless and affectionately praise the Lord, O my soul, and all that is deep within me. Bless his holy name. The Bible says deep calls unto deep at the sound at the water sprout. What's happening? See, we can maintain our inner life by expressing passionate pursuit of God's presence. When you and I passionately pursue God, we are strengthening our inner. Listen, anybody who is dead, cold, aloof, irresponsive is not pursuing God. You can tell me you just cool, you nonchalant, but I'm going to tell you something. Pursuit is a great indication of how hungry you are. And when it is that you pursue God with ardent zeal, with passion, with adoration, God's got to pour something. Come on now. He's got to pour something back into you. I've never seen a silent worshiper, irresponsive worshiper. Something's got to happen. Hands got to be lifted. Mouth has got to open. Some kind of praise has got to come out of your mouth. So we begin to maintain our inner life with passionate pursuit. Listen, you can't worship God and your mind be on yesterday. You cannot worship God and complaining about my ache and my pain. David says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall be continually upon my lips. And so when he says, bless the Lord, all my soul and all that is within me, he's commanding everything in his inner self to express praise unto God. And so that is one of the ways that we maintain our inner life. And if you want to, if you want to clean out that stuff that's lurking around in your soul, trying to chain you up, trying to keep you bound, when you begin to praise God with everything that's within you, the Spirit of the Lord will begin to emancipate you. The Spirit of the Lord will begin to liberate areas of your soul. See, oftentimes we are struggling inwardly. That's why we can't express praise outwardly. Say it's time to clean up the inner life. Go to Psalm 51. Hallelujah. Look what David says in Psalm 51. I'm just flowing by the Holy Ghost. Ain't none of this in my notes today. Look at Psalm 51. Look what David says. Verse 1, have mercy upon me, God, according to thy loving kindness and according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Listen, come on. That's so tender. David's saying, Lord, I can't hide nothing from you. He says, according to your tender mercies. David was not even entitled to this. He wasn't entitled to none of that because the law itself is the acknowledgement of sin. David was simply guilty before God, but he says, Lord, blot out everything. Come on, according to your tender mercies. So he's about to receive something that he is not even eligible to receive. So he's open. He's not trying to, let me say this. You can't really hide nothing if you're a true worshiper. So what does that do? It automatically emancipates us. It automatically grants free access. Notice what it says. Verse 2. Then he says, oh, Jesus, this is good right here. See, if we're going to have a strong inner life, we got to say, God, wash me. Wash me, wash me, wash me. He says, look at this. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thy speaks. So God, so David said, Lord, when you say something, you're right. And be clear when thou judgest the matter. Behold, look at David's thought process. Look at how he processes. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. He says, God, you know I've been acquainted with sin from my birth. There's no escaping that. But look at what David receives. He says, behold, thou desireth truth where? In the inner, in the inward parts. Behold, thou desireth truth in the inner parts. And in the hidden parts, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. You know, David ain't talking about the outside, y'all. He ain't talking about downy and bleach. He ain't talking about none of that. He's talking about that part that only God can go in and cleanse out. Anybody want God to do that? Come on, lift your hands and say, Lord, go into those areas, those hidden parts of my life, and begin to cleanse me with hyssop, that I shall be whiter than snow. Thank you for your mercy. I receive it now. I grant you the consent to go in and do your work in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. But I love this. Woo! Let's keep going. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. That the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Then he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. David is solely talking about his inner life. The inner life. Inner life. Say the inner life. Now, we have struggles in our inner life. How many of y'all know that be true? All right? I want you to go with me to Romans. I got a little time. Hallelujah. I want you to see the sound of your and my inner life. And this is why we must maintain our inner life. Look at verse 14. Oh, I thought y'all knew. Romans. The conflict chapter. Romans 7. That's the conflict. The conflict of the inner life. That's when you begin to appreciate that there's others who have conflict in their inner life. Come on, say amen. Romans chapter 7. And just a little prelude, we're studying the book of Romans, by the way. Romans chapter 7, let's look at verse number 14. Notice what he says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, soul under sin. The law is spiritual, but he says, I'm fleshy or flesh or sense ruled. Sense ruled. Verse number 15. Now look at this, look at the struggle. For that which I do, I allow not. In other words, he says, I'm doing stuff, but I really don't want to do it. Say, that's a struggle. For what I would, that I do not. What I want to do, I'm finding I can't do it. That's a struggle. But what I hate, that I do. I hate this stuff, but I find myself doing it. He says, if then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that is good. So the law itself reveals right and wrong. Watch this now. Verse number 17. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Ooh. He says, there's something I'm doing I don't want to do. I have no control over it. He says, because I find there's another law at work in me. It's the law of sin. So sin itself is what's trying to control my life. That's why I got to understand that by the help of the Holy Ghost, I've got to maintain my inner life. Because there's a struggle going on all the time. And God wants you and I to win the battle with his help. Amen. Because if we try to do it ourselves, we're always going to feel like we're defeated. We're always going to feel like we don't measure up. We're going to always feel like we missed the mark. We're going to always feel like we're not righteous. We're unholy. We're unclean. But that's far from the truth. Because the Bible says, whom the Son has set free is free indeed. We just need to know how to apply truth to the areas of our struggle. Come on, say amen. Is this good or not? Look at verse 18. He says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh. So we said, living from the inside out. Spirit man in control, in alignment with the Holy Spirit. Your flesh or your sense-ruled part of your life, which is called the carnal nature, is enmity or hostile to the Spirit's dictates in your life. What the Spirit of God wants you to do, your flesh is not compliant. Your flesh is saying no. Come on, say amen. So if we understand this struggle, then we can apply truth to the struggle, and then we can walk free. Come on, say amen. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. Shout it, there is no good thing in my flesh. That's why the Bible says don't make no provision for your flesh. In other words, don't give your flesh a vision. Ooh, isn't that good? Write that down somewhere. Don't give your flesh a vision. Look at verse 19. For the good that I would do, he says, for the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. Now, if I do that which I, he says, for if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Verse 21, for I find in a law that when I would do good, evil is. So every time I try to do good, there's evil. Trying to pull me back to a place that God's delivered me from. Come on, watch this now. We're going to say we're going to get victory. How do we get it? Thank you. Here it is right here. Verse number 22. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. So in other words, you know what God's law is? It's God's law. His word. So in other words, I keep delighting in the word of God. I keep renewing my mind to the word of God. I keep allowing the word of God to go into the areas of my soul that's in opposition to the will of God and bring my will into alignment with God's will as I renew my mind to who I am now in Christ. And the more I realize who I am in Christ, then I depend on Christ's Spirit to empower me to live out of that new life. And now I find that I'm giving place more to the inner life by the Spirit of God, governed by the Holy Ghost, and I have more victory in life over the dictates of the flesh and the devil, who we make a lot of excuses for. So how do we do it? Go to Romans. Maintain this inner life. Romans chapter 12. I'm going to read in the Amplified. We know two verses. We know this. Are y'all still with me this morning? All right. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. The two most powerful verses here says, look how Paul talks by the Holy Spirit. In other words, I'm begging of you. I'm begging of you. He says, get this revelation. If you really want victory, get this revelation. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice. So in order for us to understand that, we must look back to what the priest did with the sacrifices that they brought to be sacrificed on the altar. That which they were going to sacrifice had to die. Present your body, he says, as a living sacrifice. So every day you're presenting your body to Christ. You're reminding yourself that this body is not yours any longer. And it's a sacrifice because that body is trying to remind you that it's in control of your life. So you're presenting your body as a living, it's part of our worshipful experience with God. Present your body as a living sacrifice. Look at what he says, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service of worship. Here it is. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's the part that nobody else has seen. This is why the word is so powerful. Do you not know what we have at our disposal, saints of the living God, that when we feed on the bread of life, when we feed on the word of God, you're changing. Your whole disposition is changing. Your whole nature, your whole way of being and thinking, glory to God, is so supernatural that when you look back, you say, oh my God, I ain't the same person I used to be. I don't think like I used to think. I don't want to say what I used to say. I don't want to go where I used to go. I don't want to be with some of the people I used to be with. What's happening? You're changing. I'm not down on myself like I used to be. I don't have seasons of self-pity. I don't go into seasons of depression. I don't have low self-esteem anymore because my mind is being renewed to the reality of who I am in Christ. Glory to God. And the more I begin to meditate on who I am in Christ, it changes all of those negative cycles, all of those places that have become strongholds in my life, not even knowing that there are reasonings and rationales that don't even line up with God's will for my life. But as I begin to renew my mind to the revelation of who Christ is and who he has made me to be in him, then I walk free in the liberty wherewith he has called me, and I'm no longer entangled again in yokes of bondage. I don't willingly receive the lies of the enemy about me. I am who God says I am. I have what God says I have. And I can do what God says I can do. I keep renewing my mind. Our minds and the maintenance of our minds are so critical to what happens in your inner life. Y'all remember that thing in the world, a mind is a terrible thing to waste? It is true. In retrospect to God's word, the time that you put in fortifying your life in the word of God, you're anchoring your soul in truth, that when things begin to come that are contrary to truth, you have something that's more enduring. You have something, glory to God, that's more trustworthy. You have something that is more reliable, that stands against and refutes the lies and things that set themselves in opposition to the reality of what Christ now has provided for you and I through his word. You now have something that becomes an anchor for your soul. Come on, amen. He says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, we said last week that our souls are the personality centers of our being, from which our mind, our will, and our emotions operate. So you are spirit, soul, and body. Say it with me, I am spirit, I am soul, and I am body. But your soul is the personality center. When I meet you, I meet your soul. You've seen people, man, you mean just as young, but somebody else say, that person is an old soul. You're meeting the soul of a person. The Bible says God breathed into man the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So with our souls, we choose either to listen to or obey the lust of our flesh or the desires of the Holy Spirit. And I said last week, the soul of a person is the courtroom where life decisions are made. Deliberations are taking place in your inner life. Every day, deliberations are taking place in the courtroom of your soul. There are case studies taking place. Deliberations are taking place. You have a defense attorney and you have a prosecution taking place right there in your soul. And so it is the seat of the self-life and the fountain from which character traits such as self-confidence, this is why we got to renew our mind, self-confidence, is linked to the revelation of truth beginning to change or to renew our minds to the revelation of what God has established for you and I about us. Self-confidence, self-pity, self-seeking, self-affirmation all originate from the soul. And I said last week, our spirits contain the inner man about which the scriptures speak. Now, I can't go over that real quick, but I want to end here with the next probably 10 minutes and I'll stop. The soul and the body battle with the spirit for supremacy. So you got two that are antagonistic, your soul and your body. Your soul did not get saved when you said yes to Jesus. It's daily being saved. Your body definitely did not get saved. It's waiting for the day of redemption. But your soul can be daily saved. It can become more sanctified and set apart by truth. And so we continue to live in a state of defeat until we die to self and allow the spirit to have control over every aspect of our lives, both inner and outer life. It is what dominates the inner life that controls our outer life. It is what dominates the inner life that controls our outer life. It is God's desire and design for human beings that we live always directed by the born-again nature. What does that mean? When I say yes to Jesus, when I repent of my sins, I become born again, I'm made alive unto God, which is in step with God's Spirit. Therefore, an understanding of our lives submitted to and led by the Spirit is critical to us living victoriously. You cannot be adequately led by the Spirit of God constantly sowing to your flesh. Galatians chapter 6, verse 8. Y'all look it up for yourself. Now, there's so much in this message. Let's end with this. So the inner life needs an environment that is conducive to healthy spiritual growth. Say, my inner life needs an environment that's conducive to healthy spiritual growth. You and I must create an atmosphere. God gave Adam a perfect atmosphere. He gave him an atmosphere that was enveloped by his presence. And you and I in the earth can create that atmosphere as we draw near to God through prayer. So prayer is a key and the means for supercharging your inner life. It is how we keep our inner life built up. So the best way to learn how to pray is to pray. You don't learn how to pray by reading books. As a matter of fact, trouble will help you pray. All you need is some trouble. And have you ever noticed that God don't remove trouble from your life? Because he's trying to give you an atmosphere in which to develop a praying life. So he does not, listen, do you know how prideful you and I would be if God left all the trouble out of your life and you solved all of your problems, you would have no need for God. But God says, I'll fix you. I got you. I know what it's going to take to make sure you seek me. I'm going to give you some trouble. And I'm going to make sure that you always have trouble so that you will grow more dependent upon Kobo. Trouble will make you fall in love with God. It'll make you develop your intimate life with him. And that's why he has enveloped my life with trouble, because he knows what it's going to take for me to pursue him. And I stopped questioning God about why it is that I got trouble always wrapped around my life. I know what it is. You want me to stay on my knees. And while I'm down there wrapped in trouble, I got to get my mind off myself and pray for somebody else at the same time. Because you, come on, if you're going to reap, come on, you got to sow. And you got to sow for somebody else. While you're going through your hardship, take your mind off yourself and just love God's presence and be confident that he knows how to take care of you. He knows how to bring you through. He knows how to uphold you. God's got it. And all we got to do is hold on to him and everything that we bring, all the people we bring before him. He's not only going to take care of you, but he's going to take care of them too. Prayer. Somebody shout prayer. So what do? We supercharge our lives. Prayer is the conduit that connects us to the power source. And so in Jude 1:20, one of the most powerful verses in the letter of Jude, it simply says, "But you, beloved, build yourselves up," amplified, "on the foundation of your most holy faith, continually progress, rise like an edifice higher and higher, pray in the Holy Spirit." The most detrimental thing to anybody who calls themselves a Christian is not to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because you're missing an opportunity to supercharge your inner life minute by minute, hour by hour, week by week, month by month, year by year, just praying in the Holy Ghost at home, at work, in the bathroom, doing the dishes, on the bus, the train, wherever you are. Come on, praying in the Holy Ghost. What's that? All hell's raging against you. And you realize, I got to connect to the power source. I got to hook up with heaven. And the moment you do that, and you, come on now, you lose sight of this realm, and you hook up with God. What happens is you start building up, supercharging your inner man. And I don't care what's going on out here. I guarantee you, if you pray long enough, your prayer's going to turn into a praise. If you start to praise, it's going to turn into an opportunity to worship God for his goodness. So we supercharge our inner life. We fortify our. I pray in the name of Jesus that the church of the living God is going to come into a season where we realize why God says my house shall be called a house of prayer. The Bible says praying always with all prayer, all manner of prayer and entreaty, and watching thereunto with all perseverance for all saints. And it means to build. You're constructing. Say, I got an outer house, got an inner house. You're constructing the inner house. Nobody sees your inner house. You're building that thing up, I'm telling you. And see, it's so astounding because you start building 1 year and you stay consistent and you keep building and still keep connecting with God and keep seeking God. And all of a sudden you realize, wait a minute, I'm making progress. I'm rising higher. Situations don't affect me like they used to. When things come, whoo, Jesus, it don't bother me like it used to. So what happens? You confirm yourself in God. You edify yourself. You embolden yourself. You embolden yourself. And that's what makes us more bold. Paul prayed in Colossians. He said, pray for me that utterance may be given me. In other words, he realized that the prayers of the saints, not only his own prayers, it made him bolder. It made him fearless. How many of y'all want to be fearless? And this is how you're going to strengthen your inner life. By praying. Every head be bowed.